On my way home, I took the back road between Mona and Santaquin, and I ran onto this old pioneer homestead. And so it really intrigued me just because of the character of it, and it's very typical of the old pioneer homes. I did some shots and I put them on the computer and arranged my composition by cropping and kind of enhancing the color a little bit on the computer. And what's nice is I can sit in my studio and look at the computer and study it after I draw it in on the canvas. When I go out painting or to get material for paintings, in the last few years, I've been hooked on digital photography because you can capture things in almost any light level. I got a wonderful new camera that allows me to shoot at very low light levels. But now I've just taken it off the easel, put it in a frame, so it helps me study it even more. It isolates the painting and I can see the details. I can see them right now just looking at it, just a few little things I can accent. It's getting near the finished stage. Probably hang it on my wall in my studio and let it dry and study it for a while. After putting it in the frame, I can see a couple little highlights that I could enhance just very quickly while it's wet. So I'm gonna take a little of my bright gray and just put some accents on the tree trunks. I kind of softened them off and now I'm gonna go back and accent because I notice that they have quite a strong little light right on the edge of them. I usually work from dark to light, so the little highlights are the very last things I usually put in a painting. But they have kind of a silvery trunk to them. If you work and try and darken down a color that's already opaque and light with oils, they have a tendency to go muddy on you. So I try to preserve the little bright highlights right to the end of the painting. I spent a couple of years in the military years ago in the 50s as a photographer. But then we used the old speed graphic camera. It was all on print film. And it's a whole different world nowadays. With digital photography, there's so many things you can do that you couldn't do before. See, the colors are a lot more than the photograph. Like I say, the leaves hadn't come out when I photographed it, so I added the color like it was that soft spring green that comes out first. Then it'll get a rich dark green, but I kind of like that soft pale green. On the same day I went out to Burriston Pond, as I was coming away from Burriston Pond, I ran across this old pioneer home there, and I'm sure they settled there because they had this beautiful big freshwater pond right near it, plenty of water. And so it was spring and the trees were just starting to leaf out. And so I did some shots, took three or four shots and got the right light. And I wanted to show the snow on the mountain and kind of help show that it was still in the springtime of the year. But I tried to leave the brush marks showing. I think the brush marks, as you suggest texture, like the texture in the grass and the texture on the trees and the texture of the mountain. But I don't like to blend them out. Like in a photograph, everything is really refined and smooth. As you stroke in your different things, almost are like a symbol of the textures that are there. So I like to leave them so that there's some life to the textures of the brush in the painting. On this one, I put a road in, because there was a railroad track going across there and it wasn't a very good part of the composition. So this is where I added the road to lead your eye into the wards where the house is. So the road kind of pulls you back and into the center focal point of the painting. There's a lot of power to the very actual physical center. If you go across, that center area is the most potent thing in a composition. And so by placing it near the center, not dead center, but near the center, the focal point then has more attraction and there's a lot of power to it in pulling you into the painting as a subject matter. I don't know how many more years I'm going to be able to travel, but as long as I can, I like to go back to some of these places. Last fall, it was September 07, my son and my daughter and I took a trip to Italy. And it was kind of a trip to go back in time, because I spent almost 2 years in Italy in the 50s in the military. And then I've been back with students over there, taking them traveling and teaching. But one of my favorite spots in the world is Tuscany in Italy. And since I spent that time there, so we went back last fall, my son was very kind. He drove me everywhere. We went all through Tuscany. We went to Rome first, and then we went to Tuscany and spent about 4 or 5 days just driving through the hill country of Tuscany. And this is a painting that it's just one of some of the old farms, and they have these beautiful cypress trees just growing everywhere. And it's the signature of that part of the world. And they have the olive groves, and then they have the grape arbors with their grapes. And so you get an assortment of colors. You get the gray greens in the olives, and then you get the brighter greens in the grape fields. And then these hazy mountains and things give you beautiful blues. And artists love to go to Tuscany just because of the color there. The colors are so fun to achieve. I like to kind of paint around a theme, so out of that trip I'll go and get a lot of material and then come back and let it digest in my mind and work on my computer and work on composition, and then I get the painting the way I want to paint it, then I start painting with the computer to help my memory. I think on this trip I did about almost 10 paintings from the results of that one trip. Here's another small sketch. This is another 12 by 16, but it's just a little farmhouse with the trees. And one of the things I try to get in my paintings is the illusion of the light. So the direction the light's coming in and the fact that it's, I don't know, it's something that I like to try to capture, that you're aware of the light shining in the painting, on the objects of the painting. The farmhouses have a lot of character because they're out of stone, and then they have the beautiful tile roofs, and a lot of them have been there for 100 years, and they kind of have a lot of character to them just because of the aging of the buildings. But another thing that exists in that area, you can see the beautiful hazy blues that go off into the hills in the distance in the skies. Okay, here's one we were driving along and we saw the big old beautiful cumulus clouds, and this little villa or farmhouse was across the valley, and it was in the fall and they plow the fields there, and the clay in the fields is very gray. So you get all these textures of this gray textured fields and the rhythms of the landscape. There's a lot of flow to the curvature of the land, and so when they plow on that, it gives it even more. You get all the little rhythmic lines. They have beautiful cloudy skies there with the cumulus clouds. Captured a mood that I wanted to portray in the painting. In 1950, I graduated from BYU, but when I was a student at BYU, they just finished doing the temple murals in the Los Angeles Temple. And so I kind of had a long-term, you know, you start setting your long-term goals. And one of my goals was to prepare myself so that someday I could do paintings in the mural, like the murals in the temples. And so as a master's project, I stayed on and got my master's degree, and I did a mural painting for Joaquin Grade School here of Joaquin and Father Escalante coming into the Utah Valley, and So anyway, I started to get an interest in murals, and then it came that time in my life I had to go in the military. So I ended up in the military going to Italy for 2 years as a photographer, which was a wonderful time spent. Then when I got out of the military, I went to New York to continue my education as an artist. And while I was there, I had the opportunity to work with several mural painters as a mural painting assistant and learn the process and the proper way to approach a mural painting. It's a painting of that scale takes a different approach than just doing an easel painting. So I had that good fortune. While I was also in New York, I had an opportunity to do paintings for the church on several different occasions. I was commissioned to do paintings for the new mission home they had there, and it was just being redone. At that time, the Eastern States Mission enveloped Palmyra and clear over into Susquehanna and where a lot of the church history had taken place. So I went to those sites, so I started to do some. And then at the same time, they just finished a new Relief Society building, and the sisters in the New York State commissioned me to do a painting of the Sacred Grove that they could donate to the new Relief Society building. Sister Sharp and her counselor came to visit us in New York and commissioned me to do a painting of Nauvoo, because that's where the Relief Society was in. So I started my career doing paintings for the church, in a sense, or church history or church subjects. In 59, I was hired to come to BYU, and so I stayed there and taught for quite a few years. But I had a painting in one of the shows at Springville in their spring salon, and it was purchased. And the next thing I knew, it was in the Provo Temple. When the temple was being dedicated, they were just building the temple and dedicated. And I didn't know it was being purchased for that. It was to my surprise when I went through the open house there, my painting was hanging in the temple. I think as a result of that painting, the interior designers, as they started to build more temples then, would contact me and ask me to bring paintings in that they could show to the brethren as possibilities for paintings for new temples. So by the time I retired in 1991, I probably had done about 40 paintings for different temples. And I just retired, and I was looking forward to another phase of my life, and I heard a news report that they were going to build a new temple in Preston, England, and also one in New England. And so I said to my wife, and we'd just gotten back from a trip to England, I said, wouldn't it be nice to go back over to England again and do paintings for the new Preston temple? And I also thought it would be nice to do one for New England, since we spent a lot of our early married years in Vermont when we lived in Manhattan. We'd go up there and paint in the summers and come back into the city in the fall. And so I loved the New England landscape, so I thought, oh, that'll be a fun project. Well, interesting enough, the bishop then called us in. My kids were all raised, and he said, have you thought about doing a mission? It's a senior mission. And I said, yeah, it's as a matter of fact, we had thought about it. And so I explained to him what I thought was thinking. I said, I would really like to do a painting mission. I'd like to go do paintings for those temples, because the church has been buying and handed me do paintings for quite a few temples already. And I think that would be a great way to use my talents to do a mission. And so he went to the missionary department and called me back a few days later and said, you can't do that. They said, you can't choose what you want to do for a mission. And so I'm kind of a proactive person, and that my personality, so I said, well, let me take it from my background, my point of view. And so I went to the temple department, and I went to the designers that had been getting paintings from me and placing them. And I said, I've got a proposal. I'd like to do a mission, but I'd like to do paintings for the temple. And I explained, and they said, well, gee, let me check on it. So they went to the head of the temple department, and he said, well, let's go to Brother Simmons, who's head of all church facilities, and talk to him about it. When I went in and talked to him, I said, told him what I wanted to do. I'd like to do these things as a mission. He says, well, I think that's great. I think that'd be wonderful. So he said, but let me find out what the best way to approach this. I told him that the missionary department had turned me down. He later told me, he says, I went to President Holland, and he said, well, why don't you talk to Brother Hales? And Brother Hales said, I don't think you should bring it up in a committee meeting. He says, why don't you just make an appointment with President Hinckley and tell him what he wants to do? About 2 weeks later, he called me in and he said, I just had an appointment with President Hinckley. And President Hinckley says, great, we'll call him as a painter for the church. And he said, I would be the first painter called on a mission since they were called the ones in 1900 to go back and to Paris to study, to do paintings for the Salt Lake Temple and some of the other temples to get training so they could do murals. I might say in the meantime, when I was younger, I had this goal to do murals, but then they changed the ordinances and they started to do the movies, and so they didn't move from room to room like they did in the traditional old temples, and so there was no need for the murals. Then the interior designers were substituting landscapes and paintings as the counteract and counterpoint for decorative work in the temple. At that time, we had made the proposal to go to New England and England. So when we were about ready to leave, we were packing our car, and Brother Weiss, who was one of the designers, said, well, we just finished the temple in Orlando, and we're wondering if you'd like to do some for that too. And I said, well, you've got all this time. We'll go wherever you'd like us to go to do these paintings. We'd love to go. I'd never been to Florida, and so we packed our car, and we loaded up our gear, and had made arrangements for a place in Vermont, so we were going to go to Florida first, and then we were going to go on up to Vermont to get subjects for the New England temple. When I went down there, I was impressed with the skies in Florida. They had these beautiful, it's flat and a lot of sky, and the other thing that I liked was the tropical, the palm trees and the beautiful gardens and flowering plants and that. So this first painting we did from Florida was of the Cedar Keys. It's on the west coast overlooking the Gulf part. And it had the flowers and the flowering bushes and all of the ingredients that I thought was typical of Florida. After Cedar Keys then, we drove the whole width and breadth of Florida. And another subject matter that attracted my attention was the little bayous and the trees with the moss hanging off from them, and just the foliage in that. This next painting was one of just the kind of the flora and the character and the feeling of Florida with its waterways and that. When I was in Florida, the one thing that I was really impressed by were the big live oaks, and they call them live oaks because they never drop their leaves. They look like a deciduous tree that stays green all year round. They're such beautiful big old trees, and they're probably hundreds of years old. And they have this moss hanging from them, and this is so typical of the South and that Florida area. So I chose to do one of this big live oak in its kind of natural environment. And after going to Florida, we took our car and we went right up the coast, to the east coast, to Vermont, and we made arrangements to stay with a little cabin my nephew had built up in the mountains, the Green Mountains, and it was only a short distance from the Joseph Smith birthplace. And so we went up there and got located and set up and did paintings, but we also traveled through that area of Vermont where the church history is so rich. And we went to the roads that go up to Joseph Smith Memorial, and then we traveled to a little community where the Smith family lived. And Joseph Smith Sr. had met Lucy Mack and the Mack family there, and this painting was done in the valley where they lived. So, and then the Vermonters, when we were there, said, you gotta have a painting in the temple of the old Vermont farms. So this is typical of the valley and the farm where Joseph Smith Sr. met Lucy Mack and where they were married and where led up to Joseph Smith being born there in Sharon. And so this painting is one of the old farmhouses. Middie wrote back and said, well, we did this one. She says, I'm sure those people in that farmhouse were friends of the Bachs and also of the Smiths. So it was right there in the, it's a very close little town. It's interesting, in Tunbridge, the little store where Lucy and Joseph Sr. met is still there. And it's a popular place for the members of the church to go back. That their first meeting was in this little country store in Tunbridge. Then we went up around the Joseph Smith Memorial, and the road from the Joseph Smith is high on a hill and it goes down the hill. And there is also then at the bottom of the road is the White River, and it runs through the valley there. And it's a very, very serene and placid river. And I painted it, and I wanted to do one in the fall, so I painted one of it in the fall. In my own mind, I thought, well, that river is so much fun that I'm sure when Joseph was a little boy, he went down there swimming, because it was only a mile or so from where their home was. And the children, you see the children in the river all the time in the summer now. As we traveled around other areas in Vermont, we've got this one area that's called the Black River. And so it's a big painting. It's very placid and very peaceful. And I thought that would make good subject matter for the one of the temple paintings from Vermont. We got ourselves ready to go to England, and Weiss again said, you know, we just finished remodeling the London Temple, and we really don't have any paintings for it. So besides having the new one in that they were building, they had the other one just remodeled. We said, well, that's great, we'll go. Larry Porter, who's in the church history department, gave us a book, and it's called Truth Will Prevail. And it's a book highlighting the early brethren as they first went back to England to take the gospel for the first time and landed in Preston. And it tells their history, but not only their history, but there's all these wonderful locations where great things happened to the church at that time. And as it so happened, they happened to be in very beautiful sites. We were staying there right near Preston, and in the book they tell about the River Ribble. And this painting is the River Ribble with the, there's a park on the left side, and on the right-hand side there's a game preserve. And they both haven't changed since the day when the brethren first landed there. And they were preaching in Preston. The one had a brother that was a preacher there, and they kept preaching in the chapel there. And they started to convert their congregation. And so they decided to have baptisms in the River Ribble. That was the most logical place where there was water, and it was so close, and it had this beautiful setting with this park. And the word got out that Mormons were in town, they were going to do baptisms in the river. It was on a Sunday morning. And they said there were 5,000 people, or 10,000, I can't remember, it was in the thousands, lined up along the banks of the river to watch these Mormons do the baptism. So this is a painting of the River Ribble. It's such a beautiful sight that that needed to be in the temple there. Our bishop kept saying, and when we were going to church in Chorley there that we were meeting, he says, the saints here, their favorite place to go is up in the Lake District. And it's very close to where the temple is being built. So you need to go up there if you want some beautiful subject matter. So we went up all through the Lake District and ended up doing this painting of Lake Rydell. And it's just typical of the Lake Country. Okay, another area we went to was that was a little further down near the London District was Benbow Farm. And John Benbow, as the elders went down there and first met, they met him, and he was so receptive that he invited them in. And then he had a congregation that he kind of sponsored. He was quite wealthy. He had this big farmhouse. He was a very wealthy landowner. And he invited the people from his church there, and they ended up converting the whole congregation. So Brigham Young got them looking for a place, and there was a pond right near the farm. And he got some boots on and a shovel and waded out into the middle of the pond and dug it out, because it wasn't deep enough. It was to feed the to water the cattle, or there's mostly sheep there. And so that it was deep enough, they could do baptism. They proceeded to do, I think, like 20 or 30 baptisms in one day, the first day there. And so this little pond at the Benbow Farm is a very sacred place for the saints in England. And so I did a painting of this. John Benbow later sold all of his properties and helped with the immigration to pay for the members of his congregation to immigrate to the United States. gave up his wealth and followed them here, and so it's a very special spot. Right near the Bimbo farm was another place called the Great Malverns, and Beacon Hill is green and lush, but you can climb clear to the top of it, and Brigham Young and Heber C. Kimball climbed up there to contemplate what they were to do, and while they were there, they got the impression or revelation that they were to go and print the Book of Mormon in England, and also that as they looked out over the valley, you can see all these little communities, that there were people there waiting to be converted by the hundreds, and as a result, they went down and started to preach, and they converted hundreds and hundreds of people immediately. But it's a very special place for the saints in England, and today they still go up to this Beacon Hill and the Great Malverns on special occasions and have take their youth up there, and they hike up to the top of the hill and contemplate what took place on this site. One day while we were down in that area, I wasn't feeling too well, so I said to my wife, let's spend the day and just drive through South Wales, because it's very close to the London Temple District. And while we were driving along, we went across this little stone bridge, which is an old Roman bridge. And as we drove across the bridge, I just had the feeling that I should stop there. I didn't know why, but it was beautiful. And I just looked out and I told my wife, I've got to stop here. And so she sat in the car, and there's a little white inn, and I got out of the car and started to climb around. I was gone for about 45 minutes to an hour and came back, and had taken some sketches and some photographs, and I approached the car and I said, there's a painting here. And I held up my thumb. And so later when we were back in Charlie, where we were staying, we took this book of Truth Will Prevail. I said, look up and see if it's a little town called Skinthrift. And I said, see if that's listed in the book. And so she looked in the index, and sure enough, there was a referral. And so she got to the page and started reading about Skinthrift. And they tell the occasion that the elders, after the Bimbos and all those were converted, and they were organized branches, and they had elders going out to other little surrounding communities, decided to send some over into South Wales. So they sent two elders over there, and they came into this little community of Skinthrift, and the Catholic priest came out and harassed them and gave them a bad time, so they went back. And they went back to Ledbury, where they were staying, and they got thinking, we're not going to let him intimidate us. And so they went back again and ended up baptizing the first saints in Wales in this little river right here in Skinthrift. And I had no prior knowledge to that, but I just knew I had to stop there and see that place. And as a result, it turned out to be a very special spot. As we came back down near Preston, Larry Porter had told us there's this one town that you need to go to that's really special. It's only about 20 or 30 miles out in the valley from Preston, and it's a little town called Downham. And so we got this on these little back roads and with hedgerows on the side. You can hardly see around the bend, and driving on the wrong side of the road, it was kind of scary. But we found our way into Downham because there's stone walls on both sides of the roads and hedgerows. And as I approached the town, I got out of the car and started walking. It was so beautiful, and there was such a spirit there. You could just feel it was a special place. And so we stopped, and I took some photographs, and I did a painting of Downham. And then I got reading about Heber C. Kimball. Tells about how he went into Downham. He was in Preston, and he said, well, what about in these little towns out in the valley? And they said, oh, don't go out there. Those people are hard-hearted, and they're not going to. But he was one that wasn't going to let anyone tell him anything, and he's very strong in his ideas. And so he said, I'm going out anyway. So he went to Downham, and he said as he walked down this little road into Downham, he could hear the loom shut off, because this whole area was sheep growing country, and then the village, they had the people there weaving on the looms. And they came out to see what they were there, and then the whole village kind of came out. It's very small. And as a result, they ended up joining, almost everyone in the village joined the church. And the village is owned by a family, one family, very wealthy landowners. And this earl that owns the village, still the family still owns it, and they still live in that village. Just there's a big kind of a manor house there that they own. And even though the people that lived there then didn't know that it was a very special spot for the church members, Heber C. Kimball said when he went to go back to England, I mean back from England to come back to the United States, he wanted to go back and tell these people goodbye because he felt so close to them. And he talks about walking down, there's a little road about a mile long between Chatburn and Downham with a stream along the side. And he said he walked down that road and the children followed him singing hymns. And he said he was so moved emotionally that he had to stop and wash his eyes out in the stream and felt like he should take his shoes off, that the spirit was so strong. So anyway, it had a really special meaning to him. And then as a result, later, all of these people pretty much that joined the church immigrated to the Cayman as early immigrations to the United States. So the ones that lived there now had no inkling of what their history was, how they had tied into the Mormons. But now the earl that owns the place have allowed him to put a bench there with a little plaque saying that this is where some of the early Mormon converts were made. When they dedicated, had open house for the temple, Brother HARRELL went and took the earl through the open house. And when he went in the temple and saw this painting of Downham in the temple, he went, "Boy, on earth is that, what's that doing in the temple? How come you painted Downham?" And so he explained to him what had happened there and how that was an important history spot. The town is still almost like a historical preserve because this family won't let them do any remodeling or any modernizing of the towns. So when you go there, you feel like you're in that period of time when Heber C. Kimball walked those streets. It hasn't changed. And the saints in England love to go to Downham because there's still a spirit that abides there and they feel it, and it's a special, precious place for them. While we were there in Chorley and near Preston, one of the areas we wanted to get painting material from was the North Wales, which is very dramatic, big mountains and very tight little valleys, and very hard to find any subject that would fit a painting for a composition. When I'm out looking for subject matter, I almost have to just see it. I don't know have any preconceived ideas of what I want to paint until I see it. And when I see it, I know it. And I'll look and I'll just say, I got to stop. That's it. I got to see this place. So we were looking through Wales several times and didn't find anything that I thought would work good. And so one day we decided to go over to Ireland and take a trip over. And so we were driving from Preston to the coast to get the ferry. And as I was driving along, it was pouring down rain. And I happened to just look out the window, and right off to my side as I was looking out, there was this valley and it was beautiful. It had all of the ingredients that I wanted for a painting, but it was pouring rain and it was just kind of overcast and dark. Well, anyway, I looked out the window and I said, I'm going to go even though it's pouring rain because I can make up the light and the sunlight and that. And so I got out of the car and started to walk down and start taking some shots with my camera. And while I was standing there taking these shots, all of a sudden the sky started to break open and the sun came down and these spotlights of light came down through the clouds and lit the landscape like theatrical lighting. There was big spot would light here and then another one would shine down and you could see the shafts of sunlight coming down through the clouds. And so I shot really fast and I thought, man, this was incredible, the lighting. And by the time I got back to the car, it had clouded over and was raining again. So it's one of those incidents where you get a little extra special help, and I sure did on that day. While I was in England, I did a lot of little gouache sketches that were about this size. And then I'd take those sketches back and I'd sit there in England while I was fresh and very strong in my mind and get my subject, my composition and sketches. And so I had these little gouache sketches and I'd go to my studio in Provo and work up the big paintings. And most of the paintings were 3 feet by 4 feet. They were pretty good sized paintings. Then the brethren said, you know, we're building a temple. We've got land for a temple in Tennessee. So they said, would you be interested in going down there? So it seemed like this thing was growing as we were on our mission. They'd keep building new temples and they'd keep saying we've got new temples. So we went to Tennessee and I did this painting, two paintings of the Smoky Mountains, which was a little bit like Vermont where we were, but with a little softer, grayer colors. And so those two paintings now are in the Tennessee Temple. So I'm gone, long gone. Farmers had been, members of the church had been called there as senior missionaries, and they're living in the little farm. The church has purchased quite a bit of land around the Adirondack, and they're reclaiming it in that they're putting in sprinklers, they're cutting out all the old dead brush in the valley of Adirondack, they're planting wildflowers, and it's just a garden spot. It's just a beautiful area. So I did a painting of that. Other church history sites that I thought should be in the temple, which is now the Boston Temple, was the Sacred Grove. So of course we went to the Sacred Grove, and I did a big one at the Sacred Grove. I had done quite a few paintings at the Sacred Grove prior to this, but this one I wanted to be unique and different from any of the others I painted. So we timed it to get there real early in the morning, like 6 o'clock in the morning, and knocked on the door of the little couple who was staying in the Joe Smith farmhouse, and said, well, we're doing paintings for one of the temples and we need to go into the grove. Was it okay to get permission to go in by ourselves? So there wasn't anyone in the grove at that time. My wife and I went down the little path and went through into the grove. And it was one of those just perfect spring mornings with the sun breaking through the leaves and the birds were singing. And Middie sat down in the little bench there and started to sing how beautiful was the morning. She couldn't resist. It was just a perfect timing to get into the grove, so I did this large painting of the Sacred Grove for that. And that one was to go in the New England Temple. Then we took a little trip over to the site where, on the Susquehanna, where the priesthood was restored and where the first baptisms were done. And that's a special spot too, and as you found the location, you walk down this little pathway into the woods and then onto the Susquehanna River. The church still owns that property, and it's a very sacred, special place for the church. And we walked down there, and there was a whole circle of missionaries from the Harrisburg Mission in their white shirts sitting down there having a retreat. And I said something to the mission president we were visiting, and I said, this to me looks like the spot. There's a little estuary that comes in, and I said, looks like the spot where they would do baptism. He says, he said, he knows that he was told that President Kimball was there, and he said he had a distinct impression that that was the exact spot. But when you walk down there, it's so quiet and so peaceful, and it's just a very sacred feeling. And you feel the spirit, just like you do in other church history sites where these things happened that were so important in the restoration. So this painting was done for the New England Temple, which turned out to be Boston, of the Susquehanna. They just finished the San Diego Temple. And so we have a good friend that lived down there, and so we said, oh, we'd love to go down and get some material for a painting for it. So my wife and I admitted, we took a trip down and visited with a good friend of ours, and we went to the temple and was visiting with the mission, the temple president. And he says, well, we got one of your paintings already. And then we took him into his office, and here's one that they had purchased a couple of years before from me, of a little lake and that he had hanging in his office, but they didn't have any large paintings. So I asked him, I said, well, what place would the saints in San Diego like most, you know, for subject matter? He said, what is their favorite places here? He says, well, it's kind of a national park or a state park. It's called the Torrey Pines. And he says that they'd love that. And so I went over through that park and got my ideas. And so there are these beautiful twisted trees right on the ocean. And they're just very distorted from the winds blowing in. And so it's a very special place for the saints in San Diego to go. Brother says, oh, we're just finishing the Timpanogos Temple. And so I said, I'd do one, and I knew I'd had to do one at Mount Timpanogos, so I went out into the Riverside Golf Course by the ponds there with a beautiful view back of the Timpanogos with the ponds and that. And so I did this one of the Timpanogos Temple. We knew they were in the process of building a temple in China, or in Hong Kong. And I have a good friend, Dick Gunn, that takes tours all the time. And so everyone says, well, he's a great one to go with. And I said, Dick, when are you going to take any more into China? Because he'd taken some groups that are friends of ours into China. And I said, there's one place I'd love to go if I could get someone to take me there. I didn't want to go into China by just Middie and I by ourselves. We felt like we didn't know the territory that well. When I was a student in New York years, I would go into the Metropolitan Museum. There's one big room that's huge, and it has all these big silk paintings of these areas in China, and they're painted on silk. They're probably 8 or 9 feet tall, and they're tall vertical ones, and there's these real monolithic kind of jaggedy rock formations that stand up. It's kind of like the Oriental version of Monument Valley, big monumental things, but they're all covered with vegetation, and they're very, very beautiful valley with this river. And I found out that this was where all of the poets and artists would go in China. Their favorite place to go was on the Lijiang River. Dick Gunn said, well, we'll arrange a trip to go there too and take this boat ride. You can take a boat ride up through the valley and through the river and through all of that. So that was really a special spot. So we got in there and we saw the rest of China too, but that was one that we just really earmarked to go there. And so that one was the last painting we did in our temple mission, but it was probably one of the most interesting trips that we had on the whole process. And that painting now hangs in the Hong Kong temple, and it's on the mainland. And President Hinckley definitely wanted the temple built on the mainland because he knew that it was going to go over, be turned over to China. It was part of Hong Kong, but it was going to be, that whole area would be, so now it's in the mainland of China. So we do have a temple in China, even though the church can't proselyte there, there's a temple there. They can proselyte still in Hong Kong though. So anyway, we ended our mission by that trip. When we returned home and turned all the paintings in and everything, we got a call from President Hinckley's secretary. And he said, President Hinckley would like to meet with you and your wife. And so we were surprised at that, but we went up to the church office building one day. They scheduled the time to come in, and he was very, very sweet and gracious, as he always is, and sat and visited with us in his office, and they presented us this little book here, and it's a book that he had prepared with our names on the front, and then he had all of the paintings that we had done on the mission, and then he wrote us a nice letter, and sent it and gave it to us. I won't read the letter, but it was very special for us. We also got a letter from the temple presidency and the presiding bishopric, thanking us for this special painting mission. So it was an important time in our life. We got letters from some of the presidents in the different temples too, thanking us for the paintings as they received them. So it's a time that we'll never forget.